So I know that there are many static website generators. There are a lot, actually. So if you're asking why is Sergio building his more or less own static website generator, so some of the most famous ones, like Jekyll, is you under the hood, you are using Ruby and I don't know Ruby. And with Hugo, which is also another pretty famous one, you are using Go, I believe. And there was actually one static website generator called Grain, which you were using like Groovy. But I wanted, so we were already building the Grails website with a custom Groovy Gradle build. And then the Microsoft website was built using Groovy for a long time. And now a part of the Microsoft website, the Microsoft guides, are built with Groovy. We have a custom build which does a bunch of things. We can talk about it later if you want. But I had this experience and I had my requirements and I wanted basically to use Groovy because I like a lot to work with Groovy and I think in this scenario plays perfectly. So yeah, I know there are a lot and this is another one. So which were my requirements? The first one is versioning, right? So I've been a long time WordPress. For a time I was like running like a web development agency, you can call it, really small. For most of my clients, we were like building WordPress websites. So I know WordPress and build themes in WordPress. And I think WordPress is great and it has many benefits. And one of the things that WordPress has is it has versioning, right? You have you can see the history of a post. But given that I am a programmer and chances are that you are a programmer too, we have the versioning out of the box, which is Git. So for me, the way I was going to version my post was using Git. And the way we use in Grail's website or in other things is like we change something on the website, we can create a pull request in GitHub. So if you're actually GitHub has made it really easy to like understand the UI even if you are not a programmer. And for example, I use Git through an application called Tower. So I use like a user interface on top of Git. So I am a strong believer that anyone can use Git, and Git is an excellent tool for collaborating in companies. So for me, versioning was solved with Git. I wanted to write in Markdown. So I like writing in Markdown. It's my preferred markup language of choice to write. I prefer Markdown versus AsciiDoc, although AsciiDoc is really used in the community, and we built, for example, Microsoft guides with AsciiDoc, and it has some nice features. The truth is that there are great Markdown editors, and there are no great AsciiDoc editors, in my opinion. There are great Markdown editors both for macOS and for iOS, for example, which are I am all in on the Apple ecosystem. So I use both iOS devices and macOS computers. So it is important for me that I can write my blog posts or my content with an editor that I enjoy working with. And I like to work with multiple editors. So I spend my day in IntelliJ IDEA. But I prefer to write in pure like text editors, like are a bit nicer to write, faster to load. They are not like so heavy lifting as IntelliJ. And these are some of the editors that I typically use. And I will show you a little bit. My preferred editor of choice is iWriter, the one in the middle. But BBEdit, the one on the left, is so powerful in macOS and has some cool features that I will show you. And Nova, with the one on the right, is an excellent editor as well and really pluggable. And it's made by Panic, which is this company that makes amazing software that I enjoy a lot. And they make also an they have made a handheld console called the Playdate, which is shipping next year. So yeah, that's another one, especially if you are with front-end languages, TypeScript, things like that, Nova is, and you are on the Mac, that's something to check. Then another requirement for me is what I wanted to write a post from any device. I use, and if you are in iOS, I use this app called Working Copy App, which is an amazing Git client. It's basically a perfect Git client for Mac, for iOS. And I use it surprisingly a lot. The screenshot of on the left is like a screenshot of you can fetch, you can edit something on the phone, you can commit, you can push, you can move things. So it's like a really powerful client. It has an editor, but you can also like basically like you can essentially make possible to edit things in an external client on iOS, commit in Working Copy. So for example, on the right is a screenshot of a blog post being edited in iWriter on my phone. So yeah, I wanted to be able to write in any device. And why I started a website. And this is something that I am really, I think this is something that many organizations should consider. And been working on Grails and Micro the past 5 years, and we have been hosting the Grails website as a static website for the past, since I joined, it was already a static website, and the Micro website was a static website for a long time. And essentially, it really is nothing to patch, nothing to upgrade, nothing to install. Essentially, it's like problem free. It's like you can run it, and so one thing that I know is that when I wake up on Saturday morning, the Grails website will be up. And if it's not up, it's because GitHub Actions will be down, which could happen because GitHub Actions, or sorry, not GitHub Actions, but GitHub Pages has some problems. I don't host my website on GitHub Pages, but I host it in AWS. I will show you the architecture that I use. But essentially, if you are like choose like a you host your website as static files, it's really, really, really weird that your website goes down for any reason. Another thing is that a static website is really, really fast, which is something that I want, because I use more or less my blog also as a, like kind of a, how do they call it? It was like really famous the last year, this term is like a knowledge-based systems, personal knowledge-based system or something like that. So essentially, I write a lot of things in order for me not to forget. For example, I wrote the other day a blog post just to remember some Docker commands, which I am not a big Docker user at all. And I always forget like how to delete all the images or how to delete the containers and things like that. So it's important for me that it was fast. And this is a screenshot that I took, for example, in the web speed test in the one that Pingdom uses. So essentially, a static website, you can really tune it to be fast. And nowadays, I am really a bit down about the status of the web. Like every web is like, excuse me, but it's full of crap. It's like full of ads and a lot of nonsense. And it is nice to have a website that loads fast and it's not like have ads everywhere. So that was kind of my thing. I got rid of tracking. When I was building websites for people 15 years ago, the first thing I was doing always was like helping them register in the domain and setting up Google Analytics and Google Apps, which at that point was free. And I am a bit down on that. So I removed the tracking because actually I was not checking it. So I was not acting, so it didn't make any sense to me. That's probably a subject for another talk. And in most of my pages, I have no JavaScript because I don't need it. It may be surprising nowadays. Actually, in some places, I use Prism, which is a code highlighter, which has a JavaScript file. So all in the post where I have like a code highlighting. And honestly, I don't know if I need the JavaScript or I could just use the CSS that they provide. I use this for code highlighting. I use this. We use this as well on the microcode samples in the documentation. So if you need like code highlighting, this is a good one. At least it has served us well so far, I think. And static website is also really cheap. So there's really like, I pay almost nothing for my personal website. I think I probably the only thing I pay is right now is mostly the Route 53, which is, I don't know if it's like half a dollar or something like that. So I pay almost nothing. So it's really cheap. Hosting a WordPress website is cheap as well, but it's not as cheap. And a hosting website has a lot of the pains that you will have, which is like you have to keep it up to date. You have to be careful with plugins because otherwise you could be hacked. WordPress websites go down unless you have them properly configured. So if you want to go like for the... So in essence, a static website was a better fit for me. Those were the requirements more or less that I needed for generating a static website. On the one hand, I needed an easy way to work with files, right? Because typically a website has files. So I needed an easy work to work with files. I needed an easy way to generate markup. In general, I needed an easy way to generate HTML. I need to be scriptable because I wanted to be able to run it, calling it from a script. So I need to be able to run it from, I will show you, like I generated with Apple script. I need to be able to run it in CI because I wanted to generate the website on CI if I commit it from my phone. And I want it also like to be like able to extend it, right? I really want to be able like to, for example, generate a JSON feed that I will show you, or an RSS feed, or anything that, or I don't know. I wanted to like generate like a cadence page where I have like a graphic of how often do I post. Or I want it to be like extendable. For this, Groovy was like the perfect fit for me. And I will show you a couple of examples of how I use Groovy in generating the website. So first of all, and if you have used, I don't want to credit all of this to Groovy because I use Groovy in combination with Gradle. And I think Gradle is so, I like Gradle a lot. And I think Gradle is a great tool, not just for like building Java applications. It's a great tool for building many things. So for example, I'm going to show you a build that we use to generate a website for a podcast, but I have a Gradle plugin to generate, for example, the RSS feed for a podcast given a list of Markdown documents. I have like another build which is given a set of MP3s. I generate an RSS feed as well. So Gradle and Groovy are a great combination together. And Gradle and Groovy, I don't mean like the build.gradle, which I use. I don't use the Kotlin DSL. What I mean is, so in Gradle, you can have like plugins by source under build source. So I have like a custom Groovy plugins under build source, which I use essentially to build websites and I think that's like a match made in heaven. So if you have worked with websites and you have worked with Google, you probably have generated a sitemap. So essentially, a sitemap is an XML file which looks like this. You tell Google and other search engines the pages on your site and the last time you updating them. Google is gonna crawl your website nonetheless. But this is kind of like being a good citizen and helping the robots make their work. And I generate this sitemap given a set of HTML files that I generate as a process in the build to generate this XML. I have like a Gradle task. So this is code that I have in build source. I will show you. And essentially, I told you that a static generator needs to be easily work with files. And in Groovy, we have things such as each file's recursive. So for example, I have like a set of HTML pages, which are like stored in a tree structure, and I can essentially like traverse that tree structure with just a closure there. And I use a little bit of a string interpolation, and then it's working with files is so easy in Groovy. So you can do like in the last line where I basically set the content of the file just by calling the assign operator in the .text. So yeah, Groovy is perfect for working with files. I like it a lot. That's one of the things that I like it since the moment I discovered Groovy, that it removed a lot of the pain of working with files in Java, and I have enjoyed since then. Groovy, so if you remember the XML, so we want to generate, in the previous method, what I showed you is I was generating a map of a file name and the actual file class, and now I'm going to generate the actual markup. And Groovy has a class, has utilities to build like the markup builder, which essentially is like kind of a, you are like building HTML with kind of a DSL. So you see like it's really easy to, so essentially what I'm doing here is for each of the files that I retrieved in the previous one, I am generating like this URL part of the XML. And I am essentially opening the file, checking the last modified meta header in the HTML to essentially populate the date with the correct format. So it's really, really easy to build XML as in this example, or HTML with Groovy. If you check, for example, the Gradle website, you will see that we generate a lot of HTML with Groovy markup builder. So yeah. Really powerful, really easy to tweak. And I use it in my website in a couple of places, the markup builder. And yeah, really nice. I needed it to be scriptable. So the good thing of Gradle is that Gradle comes with a Gradle wrapper and is extremely easy to run a Gradle build almost anywhere. You can run a Gradle build in CI. The GitHub Actions has out of the box things for running a Gradle build. If you use something like a code build in AWS, it's extremely easy as well. If you are like running locally, as long as you have Java, you can run it easily. And I'm going to show you that I call Gradle from some editors, which is not like the typical editor. And it's essentially kind of like, for me, it's like kind of a build tool that I can call. Most of the time, I don't need to be, when I am with the website, most of the time I don't want to be thinking about how I am generating the website. I just want to think about the content. So Gradle decouples a lot of that. So it's essentially like kind of a build tool. With extensible that I mentioned before, the good thing when you are working with Groovy is that you are in the Groovy is a JVM language, so you can consume a lot of Java libraries, and the Java ecosystem is so rich. For example, for the my website, I use the Micronaut RSS module, which has two core modules, which allow me to build like an RSS feed and a JSON feed, which we will discuss later. For example, to generate HTML from Markdown files, I use this library called Flexmark, which is really simple to use, and essentially allows you to run to generate HTML from Markdown really, really fast. So essentially, if you are building your website with Groovy, you have access to all the JVM libraries, which is a lot of libraries and a lot of power. Why Markdown then? I use not just Markdown, but I use this, I think they call it YAML front matter, which is the Jekyll uses the same, which is essentially that you define like kind of some metadata about the file using the YAML separator, these three dashes on the top. And then you have like key value separated with a colon. And if you see, I use I code it into my thing. One feature that I writer, which is this editor that I have, is that I can use the metadata entries directly in my copies. If you've seen the example, you see that it says dear customer, and they put customers in brackets with the percentage sign. And essentially the editor replaces that. I use the same syntax in my blog so that I am able like to write the title only once. I have the title like in the metadata, and I use that for the HTML page. I can use that in the blog post. I will show you with an example. So I think they call this metadata markdown, which is essentially that you have like metadata on the top of the file. The ability of having your own thing is that you can essentially like build custom things. So I have, for example, written like if I write on my blog post on the left, like a line which contains like a link to an MP4, I essentially in the markdown, I generate like an HTML5 video element. There's nothing fancy, but really powerful, really nice to write a blog post and you don't have to think about the HTML that is going to be generated behind. You just put like a line ending in the 94 MP4 and that's all. You can, for example, I have done something that is like I write a lot of blog posts which I link to something, and this is defined in the JSON feed specification, which essentially they call it like an external URL. So I have a metadata key which I'll call external URL, which I saw there, and if I put in the external URL, for example, a link to a YouTube video, I generate the embedded code at the end of the blog post. So I don't have like to, if I want to link to one of the talks, such as this one, if this get published to YouTube, I will like create a blog post and add like a link, and it will automatically generate the embedded code for me. The date published that I have there also, for example, I put it in the blog post result in HTML automatically, and I also add it in the HTML head section of the page, and the same for keywords. So I can have like keywords separated by commas, and it's generate like I can navigate post via tags. So that's like that's cool. I actually used to support, and I think I will probably use it back, having like a line with tags which start with hashtag. In the blog post, which is the way I writer does it, and I will probably do it because that way I could essentially navigate my post directly in I writer without even trying to go to the website. I have a snippet of I use this text expansion snippet called text expander. So essentially I have a keyword shortcut that when I paste it, it essentially will ask me for the blog post and populate like the date published and everything. It will give me like a drop-down for dates. I will show you in a demo. This is quite handy because then you don't have to think about the date format, which is always a pain. It essentially will populate the date with the current date, which is nice. And let me show you an example of BB Edit is a really powerful editor. It's a really editor well integrated into Mac, which has been forever in Mac OS, and it has one thing. It supports AppleScript. AppleScript is this scripting language that integrates into many applications, really low level into all the operating system. And they support something which is that when you save a document in BB Edit, you can have essentially, they call it an attachment script, which essentially it calls a script in the moment you save. So I wrote an Apple script that if you see it calls the Gradle build. So essentially it goes to my, so the way I structure things in my computer is I have a folder on the root called GitHub, and then I have the name of the GitHub organization or the user profile in my case, and then the name of the repo. So if I am switching computers, it's always the same structure. So I essentially, if I am editing a file in this folder and the file ends with MD, which is the markdown file, I go and I build, and essentially goes to the terminal, opens a terminal in macOS and runs this script. So essentially it will build the website for me. And let me show you with a demo. Hopefully the demo gods are with me. So I have macOS ships with, and we are in the Apache conference, ships with the Apache server in the operating system, and I have it always running because I serve a bunch of static websites on my computer. One of them is my blog, but I serve, for example, all the micro documentation of all the modules. If I'm working in a module, I have it always, like the documentation. So if I go to like localhost Micronaut security, Micronaut security is now probably run a Gradle clean. We go to guides. So if I go to Micronaut guide, this is like the local guides in my computer. I was working on the Micronaut HTTP client, seems. And I have under localhost, sergiodelamo.com, I have like my blog running locally. And Apache is so lightweight that that's like, I run it all the ways. I have it all the time running. So what I'm going to do is, so I have my page is like, I have like a reverse chronological order page, right? So I have it here. So let me open BB Edit here. And I am opening my blog. And this is my the folder structure. So I have a folder here called post, where I have posts. I'm going to write a new post, so a new text file. I'm going to call it Okay, for a moment I think I was like hanging. I'm going to call it Groovy Podcast because I didn't write a post when I was on the latest Groovy Podcast, and can remind me of that in the latest one. So I'm going to write a post about that. So I'm going to write, this is episode 2 of season 5, the file ends in MD. I'm going to use now the text expander snippet. So I'm going to call, I always do like text expansion with a set. So I'm going to see post this open text expander, you see it pop up this window. I'm going to say guest at episode 2 of season 5 of the Groovy Podcast. I'm going to say Ken invited me to talk at the latest episode of the Groovy Podcast. And you see that the date is automatically populated for me. I'm going to check. I have like here like a list of tags that I often use. I'm going to say Groovy. I'm going to click Enter. And there you go. I have like the format. I can do like here soft wrap text so that you can see it better. So now if I save here, the website hopefully rebuilt automatically for me. So now if I go to my browser, I have it here, the blog post ready. So as you saw, it rebuilding the website gets out of the way. It's just for me, it's just creating a file and saving, and the website rebuilds automatically. I didn't do anything. It was transparent for me. Probably have like a terminal here somewhere that rebuilt, but yeah, nothing. Let me go back to the presentation. I'm going to show you something else. This is the architecture of my website. I have, if you are new to AWS, don't worry, it's really simple to understand. Is AWS has this solution called S3 for saving like static files. So you will place there like HTML files, images, things like that. And they call it bucket. Google Cloud has the same thing. They call it the storage something, I believe. But essentially, I have two buckets, one for the HTML pages and another one for what they call the images.sergiodelamo.com, which is like more or less like where I put like videos, images, things like that that I'm going to reference in the post. So these are the buckets are there, the green ones on the left. The icon, the purple icon with the glove, that's the CloudFront icon. Which essentially is like kind of a CDN that you put in front of a bucket. So that will essentially cast, when you hit my website, it will cast it closer to your location. It will cast it in the edge location of AWS. So the next time you request it, it doesn't have to go to the bucket. it will pull it from there, and there is like a time to leave, things expires, and you can invalidate the CDN. Route 53 is essentially like a place in AWS console where you can basically in your domain, you can say, delegate my DNS management to Route 53. And in Route 53, you can configure like for this API, for images.sergiodelamo.com, this CloudFront is taking care of this. And for, I don't know, you can configure the MX records for your email, things like that. And the red one that you see there is you can like get an HTTP a certificate. So my website is saved under HTTPS, and you can essentially tell CloudFront like use this certificate, and I have a certificate with a wildcard, so I can like serve the Apex domain and the images.sergiodelamo.com, for example. So essentially, when I work locally, what's happening is I have a bunch of Markdown files, Gradle process them, generates HTML, and my Apache server serves them, so I can like always go to localhost sergiodelamo.com on my computer, and I have the website running there. For image processing, I use this application called Pixelmator, and Pixelmator has support for Apple Script as well. So I have an script which is intimidating when you see it in the presentation, but I will show you what it does. It essentially like will try to like resize an image, whether it's a PNG or a JPEG, because I don't want to be like, if I have like a 4,000 pixel wide image, I don't want to be posting that to the website. So I essentially I resize it to at most 1,000 to 24, and then I generate like I essentially generate a Markdown link to the image. Let me show you. And I use one feature. Another thing before I show you that is I use this, you can call it an FTP client. I use this application called Transmit, which is an application which you can connect to an FTP server, you can connect to an SFTP server, but you can connect also to an S3 bucket, and you can copy files. And they have a great feature, which is you can sync files from a folder in your computer to the bucket. And essentially, we'll go through all the files. And if you have a file that is not in the bucket, it will upload it. So I have a folder in my computer under images.sergiodelamo-dist, which essentially contains the things that are in the public bucket. And I can sync it. So it has like a way to sync it. And again, you can create a script which, when you invoke it, it syncs automatically. So I don't have to go and click the program and sync. I can run a script and sync automatically. And just to close this thing, BBEdit has a great thing, which is you can create an attachment script that when you drag a file into the editor, it allows you to drag to run a shortcut. So essentially, what I'm going to show you is like when I drag an image into the BBEdit editor, it's going to resize the image with the Pixelmator, and it's going to upload it to the S3 bucket, to the CDN, and it's going to copy a Markdown link into the clipboard. Let me show that to you. So I have this post that we started to write, right? And the post, it's a bit lonely. So I'm going to come here and I'm going to try to save this image. So I save the image to downloads. Let me check the image. So I'm going to take the image here and I'm going to drag it into the editor. And when I drop it, you're going to see Pixelmator opening and Transmit opening. So Pixelmator is opening on the bottom. Actually, it's opening another monitor. And Pixelmator, it's opening in another monitor. So Transmit is running here in this monitor. So essentially copy, and you see that inserted the link. So if I now save this file, it's going to rebuild the website. You see the terminal rebuilding the website. And if I go here, I have the image already published in the internet and ready to be put in my website. I think this is pretty cool. Okay. Back to the presentation. Let me show you how I use this with iWriter as well. So if I open iWriter and I go to my blog, the nice thing about iWriter is that I can run like, I can present the post and it will essentially automatically understand this markup and replace those. So essentially this, and they have support also for theming. So this is a way to preview your post while you are writing without even having to like, even having to publish to the local server. So this is really nice also when you write on an iPad or on a phone where you don't have like, you cannot run Gradle on iOS. In Nova, which is a scriptable application, you can have like custom scripts. So I have a custom script that runs Gradle build and Gradle clean. So I can, when essentially when I write a post, I can run a command B and this will essentially build my build website. And I can run a command shift K, which is like the standard in macOS, for example, in Xcode. And this will clean the project. So now if I refresh the website, it's not, it doesn't exist. If I now run here the hammer or command B, it will build the website. So essentially, again, Gradle gets out of the way, Groovy gets out of the way. They are powering the website, but you are dealing with Markdown files. Back to the presentation. So I just saw you this with Coda. What about RSS? So I use this module, the RSS core, to generate the RSS feed, and I generate also a JSON feed. What is a JSON feed? So essentially, Brent Simons and Mayton Rees. Brent Simons is the guy who built like NetNewsWire, which now is an open source RSS reader for macOS, and it has been around for a long time. And Mayton Rees, I think he's like involved in Microblog, if I am not mistaken. Essentially, RSS is XML and it's a bit pain. And essentially, they created a more or less like a standard to define an RSS feed in JSON. So this is essentially like a JSON feed, which has, if you have worked with RSS, it's similar to an RSS. It will remind you, it has like the items entry and essentially it's pretty similar to generate a JSON feed to an RSS feed. The advantage is that because it's JSON, it's much easier to parse, essentially. So this is, I am pretty excited about this. We have support for Micronaut to generate a JSON feed, and I use it, for example, on my own website. So if you go to sergiodelamo.com/feed.json, that's like a JSON feed, and you can read a JSON feed in an RSS client. For example, I have here NetNewsWire, and this is my JSON feed being generated. And JSON feeds have some things, for example, it understands that this post contains a link to an external link and you have like a link there. So I have here both an RSS feed and a JSON feed. Yeah, really, I think having a JSON feed and an RSS feed can really allow for integrations to your website or to your application. And I am quite excited about that. In terms of deployment, when I am locally, I could like commit and CI will take care. I could like generate the HTML and deploy it to the bucket. On the phone, my only option, and this is what I have set up, and this is typically what I do. What I do when I am in an iOS device is I essentially will commit to GitHub. GitHub runs via GitHub Actions my build, and then it publishes to the S3 bucket. Are there any questions before I show you any examples? No questions, I guess. Have the chat open here. So let me show you the build. It's a public repository in my website, so you can check it out. It's not the prettiest code, but so this is essentially the root of my website. It's like still some old packaging that is part of the code that we used to build Micronaut. So I have a plugin which I wrote under source in Groovy Gradle. I have here the website plugin, which extends from base plugin. So I have like available the build task, register a couple of tasks. One is the one for generating the sitemap, another one is for generating the blog and for copying the assets. And I have an extension, so you can create like extensions in Gradle so that you can easily configure without touching like the code. So I have like an extension, like I have like a page to like my page, like this is like typically you have this in the RSS feed, like who is the author of the feed. And I have here like an environment variable that when this thing runs in GitHub, I use the real URL, and when it's running localhost, I use localhost. And this is a bunch of keywords when I have a page which doesn't have keywords. I have some static pages also written in Markdown, for example, the contact page. So if you go to contact here, this page is like generated with this file here. And then I have a folder called post when I have like all the posts in Markdown. And I have a template, which is this HTML file, which uses some placeholders, you see them, which get basically, I can have, for example, a page that I don't want to be indexed by Google and things like that. So I essentially like generate, render these pages. I am generating Twitter cards. So if I am, if I go to my web page and let me show you how I will generate the Twitter card. So if I take this page and I go to Twitter cards. So if I, you probably have seen Twitter cards, which is like this presentation when you share like a link in Twitter. And in order to have this presentation, when you share the link, you have to have some markup on the page. So if you go to this page and you see the source, you have like this Twitter card markup here. And essentially what I do is I have like, I can show you that particular post. If I open here, like I have this banner image, and this is what will be used for the Twitter card. So whenever I generate a banner image, I generate like this is used as the Twitter card when the markup is generated. The code itself is a bunch of generates like a bunch of markup of the metadata, and then it essentially this is, for example, the JSON feed generation, and you can do things interesting, such as for example, I created a tags page where I essentially have like popular. So I have like all the tags in A to Z, but I also generated like I find the tag in the code. If not, I will show you something else. render tag index. So I created this method, which is like, you see the power of Groovy, right? So I am like using things such as this sort operator here in this map in order to collect like the popular tags. And I use here the take to just take the first 10 tags. So the nice thing of using Groovy here is that you can really tweak it to do like custom things. So this is something I wanted to do. And it really takes a few lines of code to do it. Let me show you another example of another website that I generate. So I hosted post. Are we still on time? I think we are, right?
The next talk starts in 2 minutes, so yeah, probably good if you can wrap up.
Yeah, so I'm gonna wrap it in 5 seconds.
I'll just thank you now because I'll need to go and make sure the next speaker's ready. So thanks very much, Sergio. You can still talk for a few minutes here. The next talk will start in a few minutes' time.
Yeah, I will wrap in 2 minutes. Thank you, Paul. So I host this podcast called Código Bot, which is a podcast in Spanish. A podcast is you generate a feed with an RSS feed with some extra tags. So essentially, when you generate a podcast, you submit this feed to the iTunes Connect directory, and this essentially gets consumed by every podcast client in the world. There is nothing, I mean, there is much to it, but essentially that's the core of it. So I essentially generate this feed. Analysis feed with some custom tags that you use that are defined like for iTunes and things like that. So this is the RSS feed. So essentially, we publish an episode every 2 weeks. And what I want to do is I want to regenerate this index page, and I want to generate like a single episode page for the one. So essentially, what I do is I come to GitHub Actions. I go to the repo, and once the feed is published, I come here and I execute this GitHub action called publish website, which essentially runs the Gradle build. And I'm going to show you the Gradle build. I made the repository public. So the repository is, I have like, let me show you the width, which is probably. So I have a build file here. Again, I use an extension, and what I use is I define a bunch of configuration that I need in order to have like the proper buttons to go to different things. The important bit is this one, and what I am able to do is I am able to go to build source, and here I have a Gradle task which uses Groovy to essentially use the simplest way of downloading something in Groovy, which is new URL.txt. I download the RSS feed and I essentially pass it. And working with XML with Groovy is surprisingly nice, which is one of the things that is not easy to say. And I essentially like generate all the website automatically. I don't go and manually edit anything. Essentially, you can say that my database is the RSS feed, and I use a simple build to generate the website. I have like a bunch of templates and assets for the different parts of the website. I have some assets here for the episodes and the root page, but yeah, nothing too complicated. And with this, I'm gonna thank you. All these scripts on the Código Bot repository, yeah. This, what I am showing you is I made public the repo today. Is in Código Bot organization, códigobot.com. And I have a plugin also to generate an RSS feed. I have a Gradle plugin. If you go to my website, excuse me, the continuous plug to my website. I have like the, not the built info, but the podcast Gradle plugin, which we use also internally in the other podcast. To generate the podcast feed, so check it out, and let me know if you find something that doesn't work. So I have a nice comment here, which David Fisher said that OpenOffice.org is built also with Groovy templates. I didn't know that. That's cool. So thanks, everyone. And if you have any questions, let me know. And if not, yeah, I think I went a little bit over.